a marathon program this particular afternoon. Of course, it's a chilly Sunday afternoon. We don't have sporting activities happening in various parts of the world, but we can continue talking about the same with this gentleman, very passionate about football, Fredo Penta. Vipi?
Poor sana. How are you?
All right. Tiras.
Yes.
It's been a minute.
It has, man. I've even forgotten what it takes to be on television. So, bear with me. Am I allowed to sneeze on air? With you guys?
No. Maxwell, yes. This guy is not allowed to sneeze.
And we are observing 1 meter distance.
At least, yes, of course.
All right, let's speak about the headlines as far as matters international football. Cesc Fabregas saying that, you know, he's deferred his 130,000 weeks wages for the sake of his struggling club, Monaco. You know, the financial predicaments have hit several entities, not just due to corona outbreak, but I think this has been the problem with Monaco since Thierry Henry was there, he was sacked. That's a good move, good gesture, Fred.
I think it's a good gesture, and remember, it's a personal decision, as we can put it, and from one's perspective, Fine is the one who is there, and he knows the position of the club currently financially, but I don't think it's that much, because trust me, what have these clubs been making when we didn't have COVID-19? Of course, they have lost a lot of cash through whatever, losing the TV rights right now, you know, no matches being broadcasted and all that, but still it's a decision that comes from one's point of view, that, you know, right now we have these difficulties financially with our club, and then I can forego these weeks, let's say, wages and caution the club from the crisis that is ongoing. Anyway, it's a good gesture generally for me.
It's a good gesture. While, you know, Cesc Fabregas doing that, I don't know whether you've seen Emmanuel Adebayo rant, you know, the former Arsenal and Togliese international, saying that, you know, by the virtue that, you know, the likes of Samuel Eto'o, Didier Drogba are helping, you know, building high-profile medical facilities in their respective countries, donating equipment, especially during this time of pandemic. He doesn't need to emulate on them and do the same. And he's saying that, you know, African football is crap.
Well, he did actually say that African football is mired in a lot of corruption, and that's what has made him social distance. himself from African football. That's a valid point. We all know. And I think those are some of the things you were discussing online with your guests today, Saif Mutie and Boniface Osano, who are gunning for the FKF presidency. So that's a fact of our football and other aspects of our lives here in Africa and the world over, not just Africa, but very much so here, very pronounced. So he has a valid point there. Remember in the 2008 when they were going for the African Cup of Nations, Togo, after they qualified, or was it 2006? And the match officials, the football association officials from Togo flew themselves to South Africa,
yes,
where the tournament was being held. And, or was it 2010? Those years have flown, gosh. And the footballers themselves were driven through Cabinda in Angola, which is a rebel-held area. And you take the best ambassadors of your biggest brand, which is football that time for Togo, through such an area by bus to get to the venue of the tournament itself. You guys fly yourselves and probably your mistresses first class by air. You go like you're the stars of the tournament. And guess what happened? These guys found themselves in the middle of gunfire and they lost their goalkeeper. The rest of them had to sort of dive on the floor of the bus. What kind of impunity is that? I mean, this is a guy, they would have died, all of them, from that particular incident. So when he speaks about it, he's speaking from the bottom of his heart. And I remember the World Cup of 2006, Togo qualified for that World Cup. And it was such a shame at the World Cup when it got to Togo's turn to play, and the big debate was whether they'll turn up they had not been paid their monies that were due to them. It was very, very embarrassing. it was, I mean, those are those moments that make you hate yourself for being an African. So when he talks about corruption, he's right. Secondly, he's spoken about the African Cup of Nations not being given to Africa, the Africa Cup, BBC Africa Footballer of the Year, being awarded.
The Confederation of African Football Awards, CAF. He says that, you know, they are meant for African players featuring in African leagues. There is no need to give African Footballer
of the Year
award to Sadio Mane, who are playing in
the EPL. League.
I don't know. Would you read from the same script with him?
That maybe of course.
Dennis Onyango, who is the goalkeeper in South African League, is supposed to be given the top accolade and not Pierre-Emerick Aubameyang?
No, I don't think so, because truly, these guys, for example, Sadio Mane, who was awarded that award last time, it's through personal, you know, let's say, BDM2.
Commitment.
Yeah, exactly. Because they're not there by mistake. It's their, you know, commitment and hard work that they're there. But as he's saying that, you know, they is some corruption, for example, in these African football bodies, you know, that has made him maybe to hold back from maybe giving back to the society in Africa. That point of view, I really don't think it's always from him, because you cannot hold back what you can keep give back to the society because of what other people have done, especially right now. We have this pandemic, you know, you can go back to your village, you know, say, you know, let me put up a house prayer that can help the village. You cannot tell us that, you know, because of the corruption in African football, you cannot be able to do that. I think that's,
no, that's
ill
okay.
advice.
That's perfectly okay.
Exactly.
That one I agree with.
Yeah.
My interpretation of what he said is that why he himself keeps away from African Federation football management,
and
politics,
okay.
and all that. Mm-hmm. And like Saif Mutia here, who wants to gun for the helmanship of the FKF.
Yeah, okay, yeah, yeah.
My interpretation of what Adebayo was saying is that he would rather not involve himself in
the management, let's say.
The management,
exactly.
The administrative side of African football.
That's
kept away from.
Actually, that one I can read,
that
I can read from the same.
Exactly. But trying to seek for top seat in Ivory Coast, getting snapped, this candidate are getting snapped by, you know, former fellow players, the likes of, you know, Didier
Zokora.
His vice captain. Ivory Coast.
You know, sometimes when you look at these matches, as we are seeing, actually, when Adebayo says, now I get your point, when Adebayo says, you know, I don't want to get involved in these administrative issues in African football because we have a lot of corruption. Maybe these guys, the likes of Didier Zokora, you know, snubbing Drogba from his turn to give a chance at the leadership of Ivory Coast Football Association, you know, you fail to understand why. Is it because, you know, they don't like what he wants to do, or is it like they have been told, you know, you just snap this guy, maybe you can get a few chums, as Adebayo is saying, you know, we have a lot of corruption in African football. So I would like to have the reasons why they are snubbing, because
someone was saying that maybe it's lacking touch with the reality now that you know Drogba played prominently in overseas leagues in Europe, in France, at Chelsea, in English Premier League. Maybe he lacked being close to the ground, and that's why, you know, his candidacy was snubbed.
Drogba left Ivory Coast at the age of 5 and went to France, joined his uncle to better his life. And he's never quite lived in Ivory Coast ever since, because he's got his children who are born outside of Ivory Coast, the land of his birth. So you can say in that regard, there is a disconnect. But at the same time, he's done so much for the country. 10 years ago, about 9 years or so, 2011, the country was almost burning. It took Drogba's voice to go back to Ivory Coast and tell the people, listen, let's negotiate instead of fighting. There's more at stake to lose if we fight, and less at stake if we negotiate. That shows you he still has a huge influence in the country of his birth. And he loves the country of his birth. And he's very determined, maybe even more than some people who've never left the country there, for the betterment of Ivory Coast. And he's done a lot of other things in terms of development, maybe the charity, let's call it charity overall. But then again, Africa, you need to connect with the people. And the people, especially when you're endeavoring for such a seat, you want an endorsement from your peers. These were his peers who rejected him. I don't know why. I really cannot tell you why. All of them in total. Because those who abstained, and abstinence is as good as a veto. you cannot, you're simply saying, I'm totally against this. In total, you have no preferred candidates. Yes,
in this race.
So you're as good as those who are voting against Drogba or whoever else, which is not an endorsement.
Of course, Drogba time is not on our side. Anytime from now, we shall be expecting Cabinet Secretary for Health, Honorable Mutahi Kagwe, addressing the nation. Of course, during his daily briefings on the state of coronavirus pandemic, which has hit the country. And of course, it will be getting relayed on Y25 and our mother station, KBC. So stay tuned. Don't go away, but we continue with the touchline. Kateso Fadhili and the crew. A few minutes have been added to us so we can continue. Though we stand guided in case of anything from the Afya House. So another headline is, you know, clubs in Europe, especially in English Premier League, committing that they want to end the season despite this pandemic. And of course, three gentlemen have always been in discussion. I think that the influential players as far as English Premier League is concerned, Jordan Henderson,
yeah.
Who else, you know, Mark Noble of West Ham, and I'm forgetting another one. Of course, I will remember.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that the determining factor as far as when will the English Premier League resume? Is it possible in June?
Okay, for now, I can't really say, you know, because it depends on the developments from whatever we are facing right now, because the pandemic really is affecting a lot of economies of this world. And if in England, we would see a decline in the number of infections. We see a rise in the people, you know, who have recovered from COVID-19. Then why not? We can come back to football. But remember, when it's safe to do so. We saw the other day Ligue 1 being ended and PSG were crowned the champions, you know. And I think England and France are not that far off, you know. Once you
just across the channel.
Yes,
but you can see France
exactly. So
from the white cliffs of Dover.
Of course. So I don't see the need why we should force the EPL to be completed, and we have seen our neighbors across ending their saying that, you know, maybe all the footballing activities, whether indoors or outdoor, cannot be resumed until October. Was it until October, they said, you know? Why should you, if the country is not safe, try to force to complete the season? I don't know whether it's because Liverpool is supposed to win the league.
should the FA do the same way Kenya did, you know, suspending the league indefinitely and determining the winners as per the standings? And basing on that, of course, Liverpool will be the champions, something that Man United fans won't
want to hear.
What, objectively speaking, what should happen?
Objectively, they should follow the letter of the law of England.
The standard practice football,
yes,
of the FA.
FA.
Yeah, exactly.
Football. If the law permits them to give Liverpool the premiership of this season,
fine.
Well and good. Because in actual fact, Liverpool deserve it. No team was going to close that gap. This is not stealing in any way. It's not going through the back door. It's not rigging of any standard. This is just fair play, really.
But remember, you're talking about Liverpool.
Yes.
What about the top four? We have European European football.
Yes.
Everything in discussion. Determined as per the standings.
No, I think that's still, by the standings.
Yeah, but still, now when you come to that and you've mentioned that, and I'm glad you did, and I was coming to it. Now, that has to fall on under what UEFA says.
Exactly, yeah.
Because UEFA is the umbrella governing body of European football. So whatever the decision the English Football Association make in that respect of what you've just brought in, then it has to fall under the statutes of UEFA.
Mm-hmm.
So England, in the case of England, four teams, the first top four teams in the Premier League, those are the ones that qualify to play in UEFA. In France, it's the top three.
Yeah,
so on and so forth. It varies depending on the strength of your league. So then, of course, that has to fall under UEFA. And then there is the issue of what about the bottom three?
Exactly.
And who gets promoted from the championship, Skybet championship?
And,
or will there be no promotion? And it ends as it is. Now, that one's... I would say that one... There's no need to demote any team, and there's no need to promote any team, because really, I mean, that's what I would say. But
what if
again,
what if the league has to resume, but games being played during closed doors?
No problem. That one I'm
against.
What? Why are you against?
I'm
if,
against.
If there's remember, I saw I think around 8 rules that were brought forward to the Prime Minister to check out. You know, this is what we're planning. If we resume the league, then these are the guidelines that we are supposed to
have
follow.
Have you seen how many people have died in England?
I've seen. That's
have
why.
Have you seen how many people are infected?
That's why. You see, for example, like Holland, Netherlands, they said, you know, this season is null and void. You know, this is what we need to sit down and talk about, because remember, the FA has its rules, and I don't know when, you know, when they were making those rules, when they're coming with the associations, we did not expect that we maybe would have a COVID-19 pandemic at that time. So maybe they did not come forward with a rule saying, you know, if this happens, for example, if we have played, for example, 80% of the matches of the season, if at that time it ends, then we declare whoever at the top as the winner. Like Kenya, where I saw President Nick Mwendo was saying, you know, we have that, was it 75%?
Yes.
If 75% of the matches have already been played, then
yes,
at that time, still, you just declare who is the winner.
Kenya is not that much infected.
I don't know why Arsenal and United fans are pushing for the league
to
resume.
Kenya has
nothing to lose.
Kenya has not been that affected with the coronavirus, if we are to go with the government figures.
But the league has been suspended indefinitely.
But you can see we have suspended our league indefinitely. Applaud to the those in charge of our league here. If they dare resume in England, one person gets in, just one infection is all it takes. And
true.
I'm telling
exactly.
you, the reputation of English football
is
goes
done.
Down the wire.
Exactly.
People will tell you, resume, resume. But those are the same people who will be on your neck.
When someone dies.
On social media, everywhere.
Everywhere.
That will be the end of so many careers. Really speaking and strictly speaking, you've seen what's happened in Germany, which is less affected than England and the rest of the UK. In as far as the coronavirus is concerned, they went into training last month, and after just quarantining themselves for about 14 days or so, and then you can see what's happened with FC Cologne, a Bundesliga side. Three players and staff already have tested positive with the coronavirus, and they've been put into self-quarantine. Just imagine, they've been training and exercising all those social distance rules, violated, and everything. A lot of these guys are young guys in their 20s and stuff. So they have very young families, very young wife, and very young children, especially the children. 2-3-year-olds whose antibody system can't resist much.
Mm-hmm.
You're putting all those lives at stake.
At
this thing is a chain. It's a virus.
It's a virus,
it's not,
indeed. So
it's not something you can contain internally. It spreads. It's beyond. They should not dare in England just go back to football. They should not dare.
You know, when Tyrus Oyaki speaks and insists, on the same. Maybe it's because of his stay in England. So Mauricio Pochettino to Newcastle, the prime favorite to land the managerial job after, you know, the takeover that happened at St. James Park.
I'm telling you, you know, look at Man City. A few years back, we were not imagine that Man City would have made the steps that they have made. But right now, Newcastle have got, let's say, a new owner, the money bags from Saudi. And if they want to make Newcastle a Man City of this time, they can, because they can get the good coaches, they can pay them, they can purchase the good players. And a man like Pochettino is a young lad, understands the EPL, and if trust me, if they get him, I cannot see Newcastle falling anywhere below position 10 in the EPL, because if they get the good players, as Man City did a few seasons ago, they are gonna perform. If they get that chemistry of Pochettino, remember what Pochettino has done with Tottenham, of course, they can come and cause problems. And I'm for it.
You know, it's key, because exactly. Newcastle has had a manager of such caliber. Rafael Benitez has been in charge some time back. He enabled them to get promoted back to Premier League from Sky Bet Championship.
Very little money.
But I think playing unit now counts.
Exactly.
Because they have to go on market and acquire new high-profile players who can help them compete.
Yes, definitely. And we're talking of Arab money here.
So oil money.
Oil money. Oil has gone down in value. But obviously, these guys had stacked up quite a bit. And you can just tell with the kind of money they bought Newcastle United for. We're talking of competing, and I like the fact that you used that word, because Newcastle United has the best fan base.
Exactly.
In EPL.
Yeah, that's true.
If you go to a Newcastle United game, my friend, you will feel like you're in heaven. You'll admire them. Those fans, they don't sit down. And this is a Premier League game. They don't sit down. They came in, probably started drinking the night before. They were drinking the entire week. They've come by train all the way from the northeast of England, coming, making noise, singing, and they'll sing throughout the game, win or lose, rain or shine, snow or whatever, hell or high water, they will be there for their team. That's the kind of team that Pochettino is being linked with. It takes him back to South America. He's from Argentina. And that's the kind of the passion that he's used to in Argentina, the kind of passion he relates with. And if he goes to Newcastle United, I can think of no better link. I mean, that's a match made in heaven.
I'm telling you,
it's a match made in heaven. With the right backing financially, and obviously from the supporters, Newcastle United will be taken back to the days of Sir Bobby Robson, when they were ruling the roost in the UEFA Champions League.
In the UEFA Champions League,
they get to do better. But he needs proper backing, because owners now can determine if they put in money or fail to put in money, whether that team will end up making sense or not. We've seen it with Arsenal. We've seen it with Newcastle before it was sold to the Arabs. Mike Ashley, very well-to-do, but very tight when it comes to money. So Newcastle was always finding itself between Premier League
and the Championship.
And if they missed that cut of going down, it was hooray for them.
I'm telling you,
to invest in players, seriously.
Exactly.
Speaking.
Serious players. Players of caliber. And there was this whispers, you know, rumors in the football corridors that, you know, they might be signing Bale if things go after this COVID-19 thing ends. Then they have the money right now to sign Bale, and he would be interested actually to come back to England.
And
so you get three, four players of good quality, then you can now imagine of, you know, I can try and try finish first, maybe top 10 can be a target for him for the first season, and then from there, once that reinvesting in the team continues, trust me, we are going to see a Man City in Newcastle.
Of whether he'll go with his technical bench, because usually a manager or a coach, if you prefer to call him so, likes to go with the guys he's used
actually,
to.
Actually, they'll give him that.
The guys he trusts.
Exactly. They'll give him that position.
So you can see a likelihood that Harry Kane has joined Newcastle.
Yeah, very possible.
To Mauricio Pochettino
and the technical bench. Yes. The technical bench. And also, but now there's a controversy. Cut. Are we live?
No, it's allowed during this coronavirus.
Now there's a controversy. But I usually have that problem. Anyway,
you need to come for coaching.
I must have been Lou in my previous life. There's a controversy about whether this sale of Newcastle United has followed due process and
exactly,
whether it's actually valid.
Yeah.
So let's not jump the gun here. Let's wait and see whether that bridge will be crossed, and then we can start looking forward to happy days with Pochettino.
We have to end this transfer rumors. Arsenal missing out on Upamecano after his contract extension at Leipzig. Yeah. And we've also heard the stories of Jadon Sancho, Borussia Dortmund,
to Man United,
his English international being linked to United. I don't know. What do you make of all this transfer gossip now that we coronavirus is with us and no football, so people are talking
to sign who to release? I think he should go to United.
No, I don't think so.
I think because
Chelsea are also interested.
He's United also stand to benefit because he has played outside of the country, and what that does to a player when he goes back to England is he introduces a different cultural aspect of how the game should be played. Usually, homegrown players in England stick to the way they've been schooled football, the English football understanding of football and philosophy of football. They don't bring something new to the table. Look what happened to David Beckham when he went and played for Real Madrid. I went and watched him now play for England in Wembley, and he was a class above the rest of the English squad, Gerrard, Lampard, who Beckham was playing in a different league of his own. And they couldn't measure up to him. And this is something I saw with my naked eye. So I'm really for Jadon Sancho going back home to England.
I don't think so. You know why? We are going to put a lot of pressure on this young guy. What I would expect Jadon Sancho to do is just continue gaining the experience you're getting right now at Dortmund. Maybe once he's around, let's say 25, then you know he can come back. But for now,
that
let him remain there.
He may not be there.
No. Just tell me, what's the young man who joined United?
A few seconds.
The young man who joined United and then was crap.
Pauline supports what he says.
Wow. It's a fantastic show. Of course, it's supposed to be from 1 to 3. But, you know, due to public outcry, the technical crew
talk like didn't
give the attention of the show. And we appreciate. Of course, we will be on the show on Saturday again, 1 to 3, touchline. But we're keeping tabs, waiting for press briefing from Kakwe House by Cabinet Secretary for Health, Mutahi Kagwe. Stay tuned, don't go away, keep it sporty, and always keep it safe. Thank you for tuning in. God bless.